The learning objectives of this chapter are to understand why a plan for entry is essential and to understand how a plan for entry into an enclosed or confined space is put together. There is a saying that poor planning leads to poor performance. By way of contrast, a good and thorough plan ensures the best likelihood of a safe and successful operation. Note that the precautions discussed in this module are based on those recommended in various industry standard guidelines and are to be considered safe minimum standards. If the company's safety management system requires precautions over and above those indicated in this module, the company standard is to be followed. Entry into a dangerous, enclosed or confined space should be planned in advance, and full and proper use should be made of the company permit to work system. The risk assessment form will have been completed and be available. Details of the procedures to be followed are found in the relevant sections of the safety management system manuals. Note that, in some cases, the planning cannot be completed without an initial entry into the space to carry out further risk assessment at the actual job location. In such cases, a preliminary planning meeting will be held, and the team will then reconvene when the necessary information has been obtained. The size and composition of the team charged with planning the entry into the enclosed or confined space and the task to be performed inside will vary according to the nature of the task and the management structure, as outlined in the company safety management system. The competent person will present the risk assessment, and the responsible officer will supervise the application of the overall plan. For small tasks, this may be the same individual, but a larger task may involve the ship management team and other officers, crew members, and shore-based personnel, as required. In any event, all those involved in the task must be appraised of the important details and relevant information. Full and proper use should be made of checklists associated with the permit to work. Although there may be a good awareness of safety matters among the crew, checklists, when followed, are the best way of ensuring that no items relevant to the operation have been missed. Likewise, the information available elsewhere in the safety management system manuals, industry regulations and guidelines, and manufacturers' handbooks should be consulted as required. Experience too should be considered a good source of information, whether from those on board or by communication with shore. Asking for an additional opinion should be viewed as a positive and practical approach, and open communication should be encouraged. The responsible officer is charged with ensuring the plan is implemented and followed. He also has to monitor the actual circumstances and determine whether they match those predicted at the planning stage. If necessary, he should make minor adjustments to the plan, always making sure that those involved are aware of the changes. All individuals involved in the operation must perform their allotted duties as outlined in the plan, reporting to the responsible officer as required. When the vessel is in a repair yard, the yard safety department will also implement their own safety procedures, including control of the enclosed space entry, which may be quite extensive and may or may not involve members of the ship's crew. A chemist will normally board the vessel at the beginning of the working day and test and approve all enclosed and confined spaces planned for entry and will return as further testing is required. A responsible officer, designated by the master, should liaise closely with the shipyard safety manager and should also accompany the chemist when he tests the spaces. Copies of the shipyard gas-free certificates should be given to the ship, and it is normal practice to post a current copy at the head of the gangway. The responsible officer should also advise the safety manager and chemist of any enclosed and confined space entry operations that are planned solely for ship's staff. It is standard practice that shore personnel usually want to start working a ship as soon as it comes alongside. This situation has been somewhat controlled since the introduction of security practices in recent years. The vessel in this incident had loaded a cargo of round wood logs in West Africa and arrived to discharge them in a port in southern Spain. The holds had remained shut due to poor weather in the Atlantic, and no ventilation had been carried out. As soon as she was alongside, the crew of shoreside stevedores were on board to commence work. The ship's deck crew began opening the hatch to hold number two, and a number of stevedores were seen to enter down the access ladder at the after end of the hold. On reaching the top layer of the cargo, one man was seen to slip and fall into a gap between two large logs. Seeing him drop, three of his colleagues rushed to the spot and attempted to rescue him. They too collapsed, one of them also slipping down into the gap. The second officer, who was watching from the deck above, raised the alarm, and the port safety officials and local fire brigade soon arrived. The problem of rescue was compounded by the added risk of movement of the cargo. If any one log was moved to gain access to the casualties underneath. Two men were recovered relatively quickly, but surrounding logs had to be secured in place and several pieces of timber lifted carefully clear to get to the others. One man had fallen down between the logs to a depth of around 3.5 metres. It took almost an hour to bring all four men out of the hold, and all were declared dead on arrival at hospital. Logs where the bark has been stripped off are known to be dangerously slippery. Freshly cut logs are also known to deplete oxygen in enclosed spaces, and the hold had not been ventilated. These two factors contributed to the deaths of the four men.